Come on, everyone's doing it. Those are the words the woman says while beckoning Johnny toward the bathroom. He's feeling nervous. His heart's pounding. He hasn't done anything harder than vodka at a party before, and now he's being offered cocaine? How bad could it be, he thinks. The woman's hot. He doesn't want to seem lame. All he needs to do is try it once, and he'll never do it again. The stories about the dangerous compounds it might be cut with have got to be exaggerated, surely. Just once couldn't hurt, right? Johnny swallows his worries and smiles. He follows the woman to the bathroom. Not long after, he's convulsing on the floor, spittle leaking from the sides of his mouth, eyes wide, gasping like a fish drowning in air. The people around him at the party just panic. Nobody has naloxone. It's already too late for him. Johnny's become just another statistic in the fentanyl crisis. Drug overdose has always been a danger, as long as drugs have existed. But as technology has advanced and new drugs have come onto the market, overdose deaths have increased. Overdoses and poisonings are the third leading cause of death in children and adolescents 19 years old and younger. And no matter what DARE used to teach, it isn't heroin or cocaine causing these overdoses. The majority of them are caused by synthetic opioids, which led to a 7.5-fold increase in overdose deaths from 2015 to 2021. There's one particular opioid that's deadlier than the rest, with a lethal dose of only 2 milligrams – fentanyl. Fentanyl is 100 times more potent than morphine, and the slightest miscalculation in the measurement of the dosage can be fatal. It can be used safely in a controlled medical environment, but without an expert administering it, it can quickly lead to catastrophe. According to a Washington Post analysis of 2021 death data from the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, fentanyl has become the leading cause of death for Americans between the ages of 18 and 49. Like other opioids, fentanyl causes drowsiness and sedation. If someone takes too much, they'll lose consciousness and stop breathing. If they don't start breathing again soon, the lack of oxygen could kill them in mere minutes. Even if someone doesn't set out to take fentanyl, they might end up with it in their system anyway. Because fentanyl is so cheap to manufacture, many drug dealers have taken to using it to cut other more expensive drugs, such as cocaine, MDMA, and heroin. More on that later. First, in order to understand where we are with the fentanyl crisis, we need to take a look at how we got here. Where did fentanyl come from? It may surprise you to learn that fentanyl has actually been around for quite some time. It was first developed by Paul Janssen in 1960 for use as an analgesic or a pain-relieving drug. It was approved for use as an anesthetic in 1972. Beginning in 1979, fentanyl and other similar synthetic opioids began to be synthesized in laboratories and then sold as substitutes for heroin or mixed up with street drugs. Deaths linked to consumption of illegally acquired fentanyl were first reported in the early 1980s, but didn't surge to national notability until the mid-2000s. Over a period from April 4, 2005 to March 28, 2007, 1,013 opioid-related deaths occurred across 6 states. Ever since, the rate of opioid-related deaths has only increased, going from 2,628 to 5,544 between 2012 and 2014. In 2017, out of all the overdose deaths and first responder calls in a sample neighborhood of Vancouver, Canada, 52% involved fentanyl. In 2016, fentanyl was linked to nearly half of the opioid-related deaths in the U.S. Between 2013 and 2017, more people in the United States died from synthetic opioid-related overdose than the number of U.S. military personnel killed during the Vietnam, Iraq, and Afghanistan wars combined. The majority of these deaths were caused by fentanyl. At the time of this increasing threat, fentanyl had previously been lumped in with a general opioid crisis. As the deaths linked to fentanyl in particular began to skyrocket, it quickly became apparent that the drug was its own very unique threat. Derek Maltz, who was formerly in charge of the Drug Enforcement Administration's Special Operations Division, spoke with the Washington Post about the failure to adequately respond as fentanyl deaths began to spike in 2013, saying fentanyl was killing people like we'd never seen before. A red light was going off. Ding, ding, ding. This is something brand new. What the hell is going on? We need a serious sense of urgency. But that urgency didn't come, at least not to a degree that could curb illegal fentanyl shipments crossing the U.S. border from Mexico and China. The U.S. Postal Service at the time did not require electronic monitoring of international packages, allowing online orders of fentanyl shipped from China to pass through undetected. In 2018, Congress passed legislation to address the opioid crisis, requiring the Postal Service to track international packages, but the damage had already been done. New Hampshire's Governor Chris Sununu said on the subject, "Everyone was slow to recognize the severity of the problem, even though a lot of the warning signs were there." Let's talk a bit more about those warning signs. The current fentanyl crisis did not come out of nowhere. It's the fruit of a poison tree. one that has deep, twisted roots that are difficult to dig up. The roots can be traced to a variety of origins, but one of the most significant is a little drug manufacturer called Purdue Pharma, and a little drug called OxyContin. Purdue introduced the drug in 1996 and swiftly began to market it as a miracle, an incredibly powerful opioid that was also somehow non-addictive compared to other prescription narcotics. Only there was one problem. It was addictive, incredibly, life-ruiningly so. But that information didn't come out until after the drug had been marketed to physicians all over the country, generating billions of dollars in sales for the company. In 2007, Purdue paid $600 million in fines after its executives pleaded guilty to federal charges for their previous claims that the drug was less addictive than other painkillers. But in many ways, it was too little too late. Following the scandal at Purdue, there was a crackdown on the overprescription of opioids, and access became more difficult. The push of OxyContin and other similar drugs had created addicts who could no longer access their fix. Drug cartels saw the opening left by this shift and began to up their heroin sales, kicking off the second wave of the opioid crisis in 2010. And then came fentanyl, more powerful than heroin, more dangerous than Oxy, and cheaper than both. Drug traffickers quickly realized that fentanyl was 20 times more profitable than heroin, and cutting their product with the synthetic opioid could save them quite a lot of money. This mixture was called China White, Dance Fever, Goodfella, Murder 8, and Tango and Cash, among other nicknames. As these shifts were taking place in the illicit drug industry, the third wave of the opioid crisis was about to hit. In the spring of 2013, the state morgue of Rhode Island saw a jump in overdose deaths and toxicology reports that revealed that fentanyl was to blame. On August 30, 2013, the CDC pointed this out in its Morbidity and Mortality Weekly report. The state crime lab in Concord, New Hampshire noticed the same pattern in 2014, and the DEA saw the phenomenon of fentanyl deaths spreading across New England. At this point, the majority of national attention was focused on heroin, a focus only exacerbated by the death of beloved actor Philip Seymour Hoffman by overdose in March of 2014. Then, former DEA agents presented Eric H. Holder, the Attorney General, with a PowerPoint presentation on the dangers of fentanyl and the outbreak of overdoses in the northeast of the U.S. The presentation also specifically highlighted the dangers of fentanyl being purchased over the internet. 10 months later, Holder left his position with the Obama administration. At this point, the fentanyl problem had spread to Massachusetts, New Jersey, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Florida, Kentucky, Maryland, and Virginia. On March 18, 2015, the DEA put out a nationwide alert on fentanyl. DEA Administrator Michelle M. Leonhardt said, "Drug incidents and overdoses related to fentanyl are occurring at an alarming rate throughout the United States and represent a significant threat to public health and safety. Often laced in heroin, fentanyl and fentanyl analogs produced in illicit clandestine labs are up to 100 times more powerful than morphine and 30 to 50 times more powerful than heroin. Fentanyl is extremely dangerous to law enforcement and anyone else who may come into contact with it. The DEA will continue to address this threat by directly attacking the drug trafficking networks producing and importing these deadly drugs. We have lost too many Americans to drug overdoses, and we strongly encourage parents, caregivers, teachers, local law enforcement, and mentors to firmly and passionately educate others about the dangers of drug abuse and to seek immediate help and treatment for those addicted to drugs." DEA agents specifically highlighted that fentanyl was being paid for with Bitcoin and other kinds of cryptocurrency ordered over the internet via the dark web. In 2016, traffickers began incorporating fentanyl into counterfeit versions of Vicodin, Xanax, and oxycodone. If fentanyl is so deadly, why would drug dealers choose to cut their product with it? Surely they wouldn't want to accidentally eliminate their own customer base. Well, fentanyl is not inherently a death sentence every time. After all, it can be used successfully and safely in a medical context. The deadly nature of fentanyl is not the drug in and of itself, but the unpredictable purity of its street versions and the difficulty in controlling the dose. Drug dealers often plan on measuring the fentanyl carefully, as former drug dealers interviewed by ABC News have attested. Navarun Dasgupta, PhD, an epidemiologist at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, who is studying opioids, told ABC News, "Fentanyl is good for business if you layer addiction into it." Eric Falkowski, an incarcerated former fentanyl dealer, agreed. He spoke about the ease that fentanyl afforded his business, claiming he could make 10 times the amount of opioid pills if he used fentanyl rather than a different component. Fentanyl may come with increased risk to the health of the drug user, but many dealers are willing to accept that risk given the increased profits that come with it. Falkowski elaborated further, I felt like I could mitigate some of the dangerousness by using better manufacturing techniques, and that worked for a long time. But it didn't work forever, and Falkowski's pill manufacturing resulted in a death and a dozen nearly fatal overdoses. The lack of quality control in street fentanyl makes an already dangerous drug that much more deadly, particularly when it's hiding in other substances that are not nearly as dangerous and may not invite the same level of caution from users. One issue that has emerged as the fentanyl crisis has worsened is the emergence of fentanyl analogs, chemical variations of the drug that can skirt around the law. These analogs, chemically altered versions of fentanyl with similar but not identical chemical structures, mimic the same effects in the body, but are technically not illegal, as they are not technically fentanyl. Federal officials are struggling to keep up with the constantly shifting landscape of the fentanyl trade, chasing down and banning new analogs as they pop up. But like the Hydra in Greek mythology, when one head is chopped off, more grow in its place, and as the analogs are banned, chemists invent new ones. With drugs like cocaine or heroin, authorities only had to track down coca or poppy plants being cultivated. Now there are hundreds of precursor chemicals, or chemicals that can be used to synthesize fentanyl analogs, traveling in shipping containers filled with other goods such as phones, mattresses, car parts, and so on, crossing the border and making their way to drug labs. Some of these analogs are incredibly deadly. For example, carfentanil, one of these analogs, has a lethal dose around the size of a head of a pin. That's all it takes. This analog, an odorless white powder, is 100 times more potent than the original fentanyl and 10,000 times more potent than morphine. It's first surfaced on the market in July 2016 when it was found cut into heroin and fentanyl being sold illegally in Ohio. Over the course of 3 days, 35 overdoses and 6 deaths occurred in the area. This is only one of the many analogs on the market, with new variations being developed all the time. We've discussed fentanyl and its precursor chemicals making their way into the USA through the US-Mexico border, but another prominent way in which the drug enters the country is through online vendors based in China. In 2020, NPR covered the Chinese fentanyl market and highlighted the fact that while China's government banned the production and sale of fentanyl and its variants in May 2019, many Chinese vendors have taken to using online networks to sell fentanyl analogs and precursor chemicals. These are then shipped directly to customers in the USA and Europe, as well as to the cartels in Mexico. Some of these substances are so new they're not yet banned, making the activity technically legal. One way in which these vendors hide their business ventures is through a network of corporate entities registered in remote cities along the interior of China. These companies use shipping methods developed to skirt screening measures and take advantage of areas where law enforcement is less attentive than it might be in Beijing or Shanghai. There's been a drop in fentanyl shipments through the mail since the 2019 ban, but that doesn't mean the trade has been cut short altogether. One vendor, known by the pseudonym Benjamin Chen, built a synthetic drug operation at Shanghai Huilitongda Biological Technology Company Limited, which is officially registered as a pharmaceutical company. He then did the majority of his advertising for his business on Facebook, of all places. He also advertised his products on LinkedIn, Twitter, and Vimeo. After the ban, Chen and others like him switched to precursor chemicals, which are only a few steps away from being made into a fentanyl analog in capable hands. Other vendors have been spotted on the Chinese wholesale website Alibaba. China already has the infrastructure for this kind of work, as it's home to a massive legal pharmaceutical and chemical manufacturing industry. Synthetic opioid vendors can use the structures already in place to hide in plain sight, registering official pharmaceutical companies or biotech firms. Hiding behind these networks of companies, they can then run their drug labs out of office blocks and shopping malls, and authorities are none the wiser. The opioid epidemic has come in waves, and the increased availability of fentanyl and its analogs has led to what experts in a report from Millennium Health are calling the fourth wave. Eric Dawson, Vice President of Clinical Affairs at Millennium Health, said of this current wave, "I've yet to see a peak." The report as a whole analyzes drug trends across the nation based on 4.1 million urine samples collected between January 2013 and December 2023 from people receiving drug addiction care. One notable and troubling trend is the increased use of fentanyl alongside other drugs. Nearly 93% of samples that tested positive for fentanyl also tested positive for additional substances. One of the substances most frequently seen alongside fentanyl, around 65%, was methamphetamine. This is an 875% increase since 2015. Heroin use has also decreased, but that's not necessarily a cause for celebration. Gerard Pytel, addiction medicine specialist and assistant professor at University of Colorado's School of Medicine, stated that this change just says that fentanyl is everywhere and that we have officially been pushed by our drug supply to the most dangerous opioids that we have available right now. He continued, "I think drug cartels are kind of realizing that it's a lot easier to have a 500-square-foot lab than it is to have 500 acres of whatever it takes to grow cocaine. However, it's difficult to determine from these urine tests whether drug users are using fentanyl and meth together on purpose, or if they're attempting to purchase meth that is cut with fentanyl without their knowledge. Across the board, the crisis is difficult to pin down, and fentanyl has wormed its way into so many potential avenues to cause harm. Now that we've established the nature of fentanyl and its unique dangers, we should discuss the best ways to combat the harm. What does an overdose look like, and what can you do, if anything, when you encounter one? First, the signs and symptoms of a fentanyl overdose. According to the California Statewide Opioid Safety Workgroup's instructions for California first responders, fentanyl produces the usual signs and symptoms of an opioid overdose, which include decreased levels of consciousness, slowed breathing or stopped entirely, constricted pupils, and a lack of responsiveness. Because fatal loss of oxygen can occur in 5 minutes or less, rapid intervention is critical. But what kind of response can help someone suffering from a fentanyl overdose? The solution lies with naloxone, also known as Narcan, an opioid overdose antidote that many are campaigning to be made widely available to the public. Naloxone is an opioid antagonist, which means that it's able to bind to the opioid receptors and reverse and block the effects of the drugs such as heroin, morphine, oxycodone, and fentanyl. The treatment is temporary, but it can buy the patient enough time to receive life-saving medical care. On March 29, 2023, the Food and Drug Administration made the groundbreaking decision to approve the first-ever over-the-counter naloxone nasal spray. This was notably the first-ever naloxone product approved for use without a prescription, lowering the barrier between Narcan and those who need it most. FDA Commissioner Robert M. Califf, MD, issues a statement on the decision. The FDA remains committed to addressing the evolving complexities of the overdose crisis. As part of this work, the agency has used its regulatory authority to facilitate greater access to naloxone by encouraging the development of and approving an over-the-counter naloxone product to address the dire public health need. Today's approval of OTC naloxone nasal spray will help improve access to naloxone, increasing the number of locations where it's available, and help reduce opioid overdose deaths throughout the country. We encourage the manufacturer to make accessibility to the product a priority by making it available as soon as possible and at an affordable price. Narcan nasal spray has been on the market since 2015, but was previously only available via prescription. Though the fentanyl crisis continues to pose a massive danger, there are steps being taken to protect those who are vulnerable and allow us all to keep each other a little bit safer. Unfortunately, fentanyl is currently a deadly cat that might be impossible to wrangle back into the bag. There isn't a one-size-fits-all solution to the crisis at hand. However, that doesn't mean no one should try to fix it. The CDC put together a list of evidence-based strategies for preventing opioid overdose in the United States. In addition to the distribution of naloxone in communities where it would be most beneficial, such as treatment centers and criminal justice settings, they have proposed medication-assisted treatment for opioid use disorder. This treatment involves the use of FDA-approved medications, such as methadone and buprenorphine, which can prevent opioid withdrawal symptoms without causing addictive euphoria. Recommended CDC solutions also include academic detailing or structured visits to healthcare providers by specially trained professionals, who can help doctors and other healthcare providers have up-to-date knowledge on assisting those suffering from opioid addiction. These, in addition to 911 Good Samaritan laws, which may help provide immunity from criminal charges for those who call for help with an overdose, and syringe services programs, which provide a variety of community-based services to those in need, can be vital tools in the fight against fentanyl. Fentanyl test strips have also been made available by harm reduction organizations, allowing recreational drug users to test their substances for the presence of fentanyl and minimize the risk of accidental overdose. The CDC has thrown their support behind the use of fentanyl test strips, announcing in April 2021 that federal funding could be used to purchase those strips. Again, fentanyl in the opioid epidemic at large may not be going anywhere, but we can do our best to arm ourselves with community care, with medication, and with knowledge. No one has to face this fight alone. Now check out what happens to your body when smoking weed, or watch this video instead.